Word.
Word. Right, tell
us. We need a still.
5K. Run it. Bosh, you're off.
How was my 5K?
The 5K. So let's just quickly. So 8 weeks to the day. 8 weeks.
8 weeks to try and get sub 20 in a 5K.
What was the start time? What was your time at the beginning of the project?
It was 22 minutes.
Shit, I asked that question. You're going to ask me the same thing. I don't remember. I know what it was. I know what it was. 22 minutes and?
No, it was dead on.
Dead on 22 minutes. 22 okay. Minutes. So.
Then we started talking about where I followed that person at the park run with the 22
minutes. Yeah, the bib. And 8 weeks later, what happened? Give us the rundown.
Well, the aim was 20, and what was quite evident quite quickly is that that was probably a duration which wasn't long enough to actually get such a big increase. I mean, I know we originally chose our particular challenges based on what was popular. You know, like everyone talks about, if they're an amateur runner, like, oh, have you got a sub 25K? So, well, let's see if we can do that in 8 weeks. And for some people, I reckon that could be possible, depending on like their physiological makeup and that. But I think it was quite evident as I started to go through the 8 weeks that it probably wasn't going to happen to me, which ended up not happening. Like I PB'd by about 30 seconds, which felt really weird. Like I remember finishing the 5K and the retest, absolutely blurring, just fell on my back, stared at the sky and had this weird feeling that I should be really happy because I've knocked off 30 seconds. Like that's, I think, is quite impressive in a short amount of time. But because we made such a big goal originally, I was like, my pride. I was just like, it's a bit gutting.
But we did vow, and I know we spoke about this just before we jumped on, like, we're all about honesty, sorry, and we're not going to sugarcoat it and stuff. So, you didn't make it, but, and there was a sense of initial disappointment. Is that what you're trying to get at? There was initial disappointment, but actually on reflection, a 30-second improvement on your PB in 8 weeks is a decent chunk.
Yeah, it was upon reflection, I guess it's pretty good. I think the biggest thing to actually be pleased with is have an understanding of what kind of qualities I think I now have. I think that with the decisions we made with the programming actually gave me a really strong base to really push on now to then try and get decent time within the 5K, like in another.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you. If you had another 8 weeks, do you think it would be 30 seconds, or do you think actually now you possess the sort of knowledge and qualities to like really go now?
It might be too Billy Big Balls to say that I'd get under 20 in another 8 weeks, but I don't see why I can easily get underneath 21 minutes and push towards 20. I mean, ultimately I was running more, so that's going to give me a better base. But I think there's key things which we kind of developed with the program, which actually provided a more advantageous base to work on. So I think.
So let me ask you a couple of questions. What do you think what was it that you felt actually I could feel myself? Was it your form? Was it just the skill of running more? And vice versa, do you feel like there was anything which you thought I struggle with this, or at this kind of pace or this kind of time frame, this is where I'm in my sort of slightly weaker zone? Like, I guess what I'm trying to say is, on reflection, what were those areas of like real encouragement and positivity you took, and what, where were the areas where you were like, okay, this isn't as easy, or I'm finding this difficult or challenging? Like, and maybe based on that, what adjustments might you make if you were to do this again?
Shall I reflect on what we did over the
years? In fact, good idea. Why don't you tell them what we did, and then we can go back and chop that up.
So we chose a 6-day rotation, didn't we? So typically when people are planning weekly training, they do it over 7 days. Well, we chose something different, over 6 days. So the idea is that every 6 day you then repeat the next cycle, and over 8 weeks that worked out to be about nine cycles, maybe just over 9 cycles.
Yeah.
So within each cycle, we had 2 sort of shorter, easier runs. You had 1 long run, and then you had 1 intense run. And that intense run was either an interval session or it was a tempo session. And the difference between the intervals is like, typically the intervals are shorter and they are much faster. The tempo runs are slightly not as fast, but they're over longer durations. And typically, like say, if you've got a tempo run to do, say you're running, I don't know, 12K, and then you'd have like a 2K easy as you got into it, and then you'd do like 4K at a certain speed, have a K off, or a short part of time that you slow down, and then you go again. Like, you could do it based on distance, you could do it based on time, you know, 8 minutes at a certain pace, that sort of thing. So those are the intense sessions, because we were trying to follow polarised training, where you had 80% of your training was in the sort of easy zone, and then you had 20% roughly was in the really intense zone. And we based those zones on positions of where our lactate threshold is. So anything.
And for those people that don't know what we're talking about, it was episode two. You got your graphs and charts out, and what you can present. Well, it's basically a presentation for us of how this looks visually. So if you're not sure what we're talking about, go to episode two. Thanks.
Definitely.
Did a Joe Rogan there on the last podcast. If you don't know what we're talking about, shoot back episode 1000. Jamie, pull that up. But yeah, episode two, we covered this mostly, but. Yes, sorry to interrupt.
Certainly. I mean, from like episode one, we looked at determinants performance, and then we looked at programming, then we looked at S&C. So definitely check out our previous podcasts in this series. But the lactate threshold is you have your blood lactate, and that will tend to be at a point which is quite steady, because the blood is, you know, the body is producing lactate as a waste product, but at the same time the blood is removing it. But there's a point where you're working at an intensity that's so hard that the rise of lactate becomes bigger and greater than the body can get rid of it. And there's two distinct points: the lactate threshold and the lactate turn point, where you start to see an exponential increase in lactate in the blood. So anything that was easy was underneath this lactate threshold point, which we agreed would be around 70% of our heart rate. So it's actually quite far down from where our lactate threshold is. So that's where they were easy. And then everything else was the more intense sessions, where we would run at paces which were considerably higher, that would get our heart rate to be way over above our lactate threshold. And we use this as a way of following Pareto's law, where 80% of your performance outcomes are usually done by 20% of the work that you're doing. So that 20% was the key training that was influencing our performance, but that is well supported by the 80% of the easy stuff that we did. If you just did 20% of, you know, 100% of hard training, you just break. You wouldn't be able to
do that. You just burn out, yeah.
Exactly. So we tried to follow that, and that's the kind of structure that we did regarding the 6-week cycle. And I guess what I noticed quite quickly was, I think from a logistical point of view, I actually found it quite difficult to juggle work and life around that 6 day cycle, because it's every 6 days, it changes. So
yeah, it chops, like the final day is kind of Friday and then a Thursday. Yeah.
Yeah. And it, upon looking at that, like, especially originally, we were like, oh, that, you know, that shouldn't be much of a problem. Like, we're working from home quite a bit. So you should
That's
be
important
able
to note, Phil. I was thinking about this. 8 weeks ago, we were in quite a different spot to where we are now.
Very much
like,
so.
Like, as a society, like, people were genuinely working at home. I don't know about what it's like where you are right now or where other people are listening, but it's pretty busy, like, where I am now. You know, like, people are out and about, trains are full. Like, I know it's still not, like, as it was, but it's important to know that in those 8 weeks, actually, life, like, the logistical sort of day-to-day movements, very different, which is no one's fault, not a problem. It's just something, as you mentioned, it actually, I ended up realizing the further this went on, like, the more tricky it was to find, like, legitimate times to do this kind of training.
Yeah, and well, training, well, life was changing week by week, wasn't it? Like, government lockdown rules were changing, how work was reacting to it was changing, so all of a sudden it became more difficult to balance everything. And it did make me think, if we had an 8 week stretch which wasn't disturbed by so many different factors, it could be something that could be quite good. Or if you were a full-time athlete, it's also something that could be utilized quite effectively. However, it became really difficult for us, and one of the key things I found difficult manipulating it was when, like, for example, I went to Centre Parks for 4 days. So all of a sudden, although you could say, oh, you go out and just get your runs in around Centre Parks, it certainly was a lot more difficult when you're trying to, you know, be with family. So I was trying to restructure everything around key holidays or key events that I had to do. And like, for example, the Centre Parks time occurred when my volume was at its peak. So I ended up running the most volume I'd ever done in a week, but I actually did it in 4 days.
And in a different location, unfamiliar terrain and things like that.
I did it before I went.
Oh, okay.
So that, by the schedule, that volume that I did should have been done over 6 days. I actually did it over 4 days instead. And then it was scheduled that I would have one of the intense sessions after, or just on the morning that we were leaving. And
did you do any training in Centre Parks? Just light movement?
Just one run.
Just one run, yeah.
I tried to schedule it so one of the easy runs was done then. And all of a sudden, because of all that huge volume, which would probably be okay if it was over 6 days, but because it was over 4 days, my soleus was just killing me. So small tweaks, like 2 days at a time which is really important in the program, then affected me differently. So then I couldn't do my intense session the day after. So all of a sudden, if you think about, okay, you've got 9 cycles, and I've lost one of my intense sessions, like, that's a huge chunk of your 20%. Now, that happened to me 3 times, where either my soleus played up twice, so that affected 2 intense sessions, and also had to miss one because of a being in the Forest of Dean of another time. So if you think over the 9 weeks, you've got 9 sessions to be intense.
You missed 3.
And I've affected all.
So you missed a third.
I missed a third. So then all of a sudden, that 80-20 becomes more difficult to maintain, just because of how you've organized life and how niggles happen.
But I guess the bottom line, though, is unless you're a paid athlete, then this is your job. There's always going to be something. And it's just important to recognize that, you know? And like, I think, certainly I am, but I think you are too, Phil. It's like, we're quite disciplined, even though we don't do this for a living. Like, we're quite disciplined, but inevitably, most people are going to have a few curveballs, are going to have a few kind of, I didn't get around to that sessions. And I think you've proven that even though you didn't potentially make that, well, you didn't do the sub 20 that you sort of set out to do, you still ran a PB. You still improved as an athlete despite the slight obstacles and despite the fact that you lost three of those intense sessions. So again, I'm like, I'm trying to always think about people that listen and are in the same boat and make excuses. And they may be very valid, you know, someone's ill, childcare, you know, you're living in a different location, you don't have access to treadmill. I don't know. But like, that doesn't mean game over. You know what I mean? It's important just to continue on the journey. Even if you miss these things, you can figure it out. And you running a PB despite that shows that's possible.
Yeah. And I think removing the intense sessions just then changed the focus of the program because it became very sort of base building because of what was left. So that's what makes me think, like, if I had another 8 weeks, I could have really pushed because I've just spent 8 weeks building a better base. I certainly would, you know, if I
even you'd lose more weight, wouldn't you?
I mean,
the more you run,
weight would like, actually help for me, but it's not.
I was going to ask you if you'd lost weight. And by the way, this guy's jacked up, so it's not a question of fat or anything. It's just like, you're a big fella, you know, you lift a lot of weight, big crash ball inside center. So, whereas my frame, you can just see in the camera, like I have more of a natural runner's build currently, you know? But do you think if you did 8 more weeks, you'd just naturally lose more size, make yourself slicker, quicker across the ground? Or do you think that's not really a concern? It's just getting the miles in.
I think I would naturally lose more weight. Like, my wife's already saying that I'm too skinny. I don't think I've lost actually that much when it comes to the weight, but size-wise, my shape has changed from just one, running more, but two, I wasn't doing too much in the way of, I barely was heavy lifting. A lot of my S&C was coming from either assistance work or just trying to be bouncy and stiff. So there would be lots of jumps, sort of low level plyometrics. I did some more intense plyometrics around sort of the last, I'd say, between halfway and two thirds. So, I mean, I became really, really springy, which I was really kind of happy about.
Nice. So that's an important thing. So you felt like springier.
Especially, you know, I was talking about the peak volume. As I came out of that, I started reducing the amount of volume I was doing and increasing the intensity. And there was a period there where I really quite felt like the fatigue of the high volume was starting to wear off. And the sort of the physical qualities I was getting from running more and doing the more specific S&C were really starting to.
And so, you know, again, I feel like that S&C section, we almost had to try and convince people that it was crucial to running good times. I feel like a lot of people go, I've been running every day, mate, but. And we were kind of making the point that there are some insane S&C type drills and there needs to be time spent on that type of thing. And in fact, you're kind of now saying, if I'm right, that actually those S&C drills, you felt, you could almost feel like a physical difference, a bounciness, a lightness, which just shows how valuable those sections of the work of the programming were.
Yeah, I really wish that the university was open during this whole process, because if I had access to something where I could measure certain, like jump height or my ability to bounce, you know, so you can do that based on calculations, based on the amount of time you spend on the floor, based on the amount of time you spend in the air, sort of your reactive.
There's an app or something that can do that, is there? Some kind of.
Yeah, there should be, yeah. There's an app called My Jump.
Oh, right.
To pay for, but that's something
you I'd love to. I'd really like to have seen your results from that, but there'll be more. There'll be more.
Yeah, it was one of those.
I've still got it in my. I really want to dunk a basketball. It's on my bucket list to dunk. Nice. And I feel like I should just spend like one of these series just being like, all I got to do is improve my vertical jump. You know, like just want to be able to dunk the ball. But I one of those apps. I've seen a few sort of athletes. They have almost like knee braces on that can kind of measure an angle. They work out force through the ground and things. It's a very interesting thing. But I'm glad to hear, just without the need of data, You just felt that you were more, what would you say? More explosive, springier?
Yeah.
Lighter.
I could feel the hang time as I was doing pogos and vertical jumps. Like it was so much more than was at the beginning. It's very subjective and I'm going off feel, but maybe I spent so long feeling so heavy that all of a sudden it felt like something was
decades.
The weight was taken off me. I've just been wearing really heavy t-shirts. I know we always said with this, every season we'll probably have something new to like monitor and make decisions with training, some new way of testing, just so we can spend a bit of time on each thing to, you know, investigate what it's doing. Is it any good? That sort of thing. So, you know, the My Jump app, maybe it's something we bring in for a future series.
But let me ask you this, like, I hope you don't mind me sharing this, but like when we first spoke after you'd done it, your initial thoughts were, I'm gutted. And I said to you, don't be. I was like, you haven't mentioned yet that when you did this run, and I can only imagine down on the coast, it was very windy, right?
Mm.
Not just physically, but psychologically running into wind is a fucking hassle. You know what I mean? You just know in your head, oh, I'm going to have to make up for this. And if only it was going up. You know, I get that mental fuckery. Second of all, you have had some niggles and injuries. You mentioned your soleus, but, you know, at the best of times, your knees are, you know.
Yeah, I have problems. I have a bony spur in my knee, which I can manage quite well. But if I go too intense too often, which I had to towards the end, as I approached the 5K, it started to get a bit aggy. It was just one of those things. I actually delayed doing the 5K. I'll explain the last 2 weeks because I was trying to taper off.
Sure. So yeah, run us through.
I did a intense interval session probably like 8 days before, which I felt went really well. Like I was maintaining some good speeds underneath the 4 minute kilometer pace, which I'd need to maintain. So that went quite well. But one of the problems is I was struggling to get access to a track. So obviously the track has a certain surface which has a bit of give. So I was doing a lot of my interval stuff on the driveway of a sailing club that's near our house, which is obviously hard concrete. Which my knee wasn't loving too much. And then 2 days later, I did a tempo run. Again, normally I would probably space them out a little bit more, but I was going to Alton Towers for my first wedding anniversary. So again, moving stuff around.
Progress Theory, sponsored by Alton Towers. Just
I wish. Rita, queen of speed. So after that tempo run, which again went well, but I could feel my knee by the end of that. So I
don't know. On an honest, with a solid knee and no pain in the soleus, do you think you could have shaved off another 30 seconds? Because basically what I'm saying is I think you're closer to that 20 minute mark than you making out. And I think with the wind, the knee, the calf, the fact you missed 30%, yeah, look, that's always going to happen. But if all of those things had gone perfectly, I think we'd be having a different conversation. Maybe I'm just guessing. I just know the type of athlete you are and how knowledgeable. I feel like that could have been perfectly possible on a different set of circumstances on a different day.
I think I would have got a better PB, despite I think what we did was more of a base building, how it ended up being. I think the key things that did have a major effect on it was one, the fact that I lost around or 30% of my intense sessions were kind of compromised in some way. Mm-hmm. I think that had a big thing. And I don't think the soleus was an issue when it came to the retest. It just affected some parts of the training as we went through. Like it got a bit aggy, but it calmed down. So like recovery wise, I did well there, but it did mean that I lost a few days. So I don't think that affected me at all when it, the Solaris didn't affect me at all at the retest, but it did slightly affect my programming. During the event, I think the knee started hurting halfway through, which may have affected me being quite bouncy. But I think the wind was a struggle, unfortunately. But
I know it sounds so pathetic, but it's not. You know, it's tough to run into wind. Yeah, especially down by the coast. This isn't like wind around the corner. Like, you know, you are right on the coast. You know, people go down to kite surf. It's that windy. So it's totally understandable that if the answer was you were running headfirst into that wind, that's going to slow you down big time.
I think the key thing to mention with it is that, yeah, it might have slowed down my PB, but it would not have had that effect on the near the 20 mark, I don't think. Okay. If you look at my trace of my speeds over the 5K, over two test retests, you see that I maintain a 4-minute pace really well for the first, I'd say, a K and a half. Then it starts to decrease a little bit. So it's like 4:06. It's not too bad. But it comes to it's the fourth K where I drop off quite considerably, and then like 1K sprint at the end just to try and
make
up.
So can you quickly run through that? So when you set out to do this, you know, stopwatch on, let's go. Were you trying to just run sub 4 minutes every kilometer, or did you have a bit of a game plan? Did you know that, like, if you could get through the first three, you'd have to really pick it up on the fourth, the fifth, adrenaline, focus, grit, determination would get you through? But how did you in your head, like, that's because we'll talk about the 10K in a moment, but I had a in my head, I knew what was going to happen. I knew what I need to do at every specific kilometer in order to try and get there.
So my strategy was to maintain that 4-minute pace the whole way through.
Okay.
I was worried that if I set off any faster than that, I would burn out. I just, because it says my pace at my lactate threshold using Garmin is around 4:51. So it's quite a lot above the lactate threshold, which it is going to be quite a lot, but that's quite considerable. So that's 20 minutes, quite a lot above my lactate threshold. So I knew if I went even faster that I would just completely die. So I didn't want to do that. So my aim was just to, like, okay, let's hit that 4-minute pace. I had experience practicing what that felt and just wanted to keep doing it.
And do you know your splits for, say, the first 2 kilometers?
Yeah, so when I first started, I could maintain a 1 kilometer at 4 minutes and then just drop after that. Whereas now I was a bit better at maintaining it. Problem is I seem to struggle to maintain it for around 3 to 4K. Cause you just, it gets this, okay, you're doing well. Okay. Nope. Okay. Sprint finish. So it's that area.
It's that gap.
I wonder, yeah.
And what's funny is my story is a little bit different, but when I first did the 10K practice, again, 5 to 6K, and then it was like 7, 8, 9, I started to panic. 10, I managed to claw it back, but there's that inevitable like trough, that dip, sort of 2/3 of the way in.
And I wonder if that's, you know, that's something that should be focused on, maybe on more in the tempo runs. Not trying to maintain that speed that often, because that's like race pace all the time, but just having tempos which are deliberately the length which you know you struggle at a certain pace. So you just have time doing, in my case, 3 to 4K tempos, just maintaining certain pace, just so that your body gets used to maintaining a speed and not dying off as you start to reach 3, 4K. And then building the speed up that way. That is something what I probably would do if I had another 8 weeks, and that's what I'd do with my tempo runs. I'd focus my tempos around 3, 4K mark.
Because that was going to be my final thing. What would you do differently?
It would probably be that. I'd probably restructure everything to try and make sure that I was doing everything over 7 days rather.
7 days, yeah.
Just because I think.
And that, would you say that if you had to miss sessions, you would lose a slightly lighter session as opposed to one of the intense sessions?
I'd reckon that's what my aim would be. I would be worried that the intensity is what you kind of want if you want to maintain that 20% of your overall training. But you might still be able to run at a very easy pace. You know, running at easy pace and running at intense pace is completely different. And you might have an injury, which is completely fine when you run easy, but then plays up if you run hard. So then you've got to make a decision. Okay, what's best? If it, do you get rid of both because you need to compete best, or do you get some kind of benefit from still running, but not to the point where you think you're going to further your injury?
That kind of leads on, I guess, to what I was going to say, which is I had that same scenario, which is I've got to make a call here. Do I just do a few and do them intense? Or take it a little bit slower, but keep banking the miles. This is now going to overlap a lot with what you've had to say. And the reason why I wanted you to go first is because, to be honest, my whole 8-week program leading up to it was very disjointed. And, to be honest, very disappointed, but I understood that there was nothing I could do to get around it. Firstly, I didn't acknowledge this at the start, but obviously you know this, Phil, like I was away working for 3 weeks. So there you go. If we're talking about losing, you know, time of the program, 3 of the 8 weeks, I was in another country working, and without getting too specific, the work was fitness. You know, it was all day, every day, my body working. Yes, there was some running, but a lot of it was weights based, which meant two things. One is I simply didn't have the time to then go, right, I need to get out for an hour at the end of a day at 9 p.m. in the middle of Milan. Second thing is I was suffering quite badly with fatigue, muscle soreness, DOMS. So, you know, at the end of a day, I'd have done sometimes upwards of 300 to 400 squats with dumbbells and then would be asked to go and run. And in my head, I was like, what would be the best choice here? Should I not do any running and then really go for it on Saturday or what? And the end result was I kind of did a bit of everything. I tried to use like intuition and listen to my body to figure out how I could try and stay on track with you and the program, and also not jeopardize the job, which was obviously one of the more important things. But having said all that, I started well with the program. I was like feeling very good, to be honest, about 2 or 3 weeks into the whole thing. Around that second, third episode, things were good. I'd had a few injuries, but when I did go out and run, I ran well and felt like the program you put together was translating into improvements. Do you know what I mean? Like I felt like, okay. And particularly, as you said, the S&C drills, something which, coming from a fitness professional, I completely neglected for the first, you know, for the last 10 years. It was only really when you came into the game for the stairs that I actually realized the benefit of spending specific time with the S&C stuff. Before, I was very much like, hit the park, run as hard as you can. 10K today, cool, let's go. I was at 44 minutes and 16 seconds, I believe, when I came into this. And obviously that was a significant amount of time to drop, but we worked out it's kind of exactly what you needed to drop. You know what I mean? It was about 10%.
Yeah.
Roughly, you had to lose like 2.5 minutes. I had to lose about 5 minutes or whatever it was. And again, I didn't make it. I actually did significantly worse than my PB. But I'm not judging it. I've learned a lot. One of the things is, in order to do this kind of thing, you have to be very, very disciplined. And whether it's external factors or personal reasons, whatever, like the moment it starts getting a bit fluid, you're neither here nor there. You're just guessing and gambling. And then you're down to your sort of your best efforts on the day. It's kind of like, you want to revise and get a good mark in an exam. You know, you got to read the whole textbook. You can't just do a couple pages and then you hope on the day that those questions come up. And yeah, if we're using that as a metaphor, like I already knew most of the textbooks, some of it, you know, like I could get by, but I got like a B minus because I didn't read at all. And I had another injury that came into play from this trip, which was plantar fasciitis, which for any runner, I've never had it. I hopefully never have it. Well, I have it currently. And I think it's one of those ones that gradually sort of tapers out and can come back to haunt you at various different stages. But essentially, it's like a inflammation of the tendons in your feet, which, as you can imagine, when you're running 10K and doing the training, is not pleasant. However, having said that, I kind of made an agreement with myself that, what are you going to do? Sit on your ass all day? Like, no. So I did do some running, and I shortened the windows for me. Like, I never actually ran any further than 6K until race day, until the sort of time trial. And just like you were commenting on with how you were pretty decent for the first half, and then I was the same. I knew that for the first 5K, I'd be all right. You know, I have run sub 20 minute 5Ks a fair few times, and maybe arrogantly or sort of just having that confidence, I knew that I could probably get halfway and be all right. And then it was a question of how my body would respond given the lack of discipline training and with the injury. And it got bad. You know, like I was hot. I was limping by the last one. Usually I have quite a nice uptick for like that final kilometer. I kind of surrender everything. Metallica goes on, and like I'll run my fastest kilometer of the event. But I didn't. It was just then became a question of like, just get through the 10K so you have a figure to report. I'm not gutted. I'm kind of frustrated that I can't do this again, because I'd like to think that given the detail that we've, you know, spent trying to program this, or you have, I'm never going to take credit for that. That's you. And my desire to do it, like, I feel like I could do it. You know, I really feel like I could do it. And I think you can too. And I won't rest easy now. It's not like, well, we gave it a go. I was actually very, very frustrated. Disappointed is the wrong word, because I knew given other circumstances, it would have been a lot smoother. And I think a combination of the job abroad and this injury that flared up, it was always going to be a gamble.
I think you were very unfortunate, because you were doing really well.
My time's all right. Like at the halfway, like Mark, I was checking in with you and you were like, you know, like this is kind of on target. I mean, whether it was sub 40 or 41 or 42, I don't know. Again, like you, I'd love to think I could have done it, but I feel like I could have shaved off some time and definitely not added time. So basically what I'm trying to relay here is that I'm probably not the best example to use from this particular episode. There are things I've learned, and there are things that, like, just like knowledge wise, I know based on what we've discussed, I personally feel like on reflection, the lack of care or attention I paid to S and C drills before I undertook this project was perhaps the biggest, like, whatever I'm doing now, whatever I'm doing, there's most likely going to be some kind of S and C type work that could enhance the more sort of the running, the swimming, you know what I mean? Like, I never really appreciate that enough. I didn't feel the like extra spring or extra bounce, like specifically as you said, but I could feel parts of my body like sore you know what I mean? You start to become more in tune with the body, and I'm a very like lace them up run kind of guy, and actually giving myself a little bit more specificity. You know, think about how I land the foot and why this exercise is going to benefit me when I actually come to the run, and trying to think about the training, you know, visualizing the growth, all made a lot more sense to me, and like a real sense of comfort and enthusiasm, because I often go into things very blinkered, and it's just sort of, I know my grit will get me there. And that wasn't the case this time. And I feel like going forward, I'm excited to know that there's some some ways to make this really structured. And for a guy that is quite haphazard, I actually really do like structure. I don't have much of it, but I really like embrace that idea. And again, going right back to the start, having Phil, well, having you, mate, message me. Right, here's the day. I loved that. I love that. Like, it had been thought about, carefully considered. It was just simply up to me to execute. It was just fucking awesome. So I wouldn't say gutted or disappointed. I'm frustrated. I couldn't give it my full efforts.
I think you're downplaying the amount of work you had to do when you were abroad. So
maybe
there was so much.
You were
training for this job.
Yeah, all day, every day.
10 hours a day for 3 weeks straight. So all of a sudden, you couldn't do your running at all. What you did, you reduced considerably because anything more, you would just increase the severity of the injury that you got. Like, you were injury free in your foot before you left.
That was my problem.
It's because of the total amount of work you were doing, which it must be gutting.
I was essentially an actor for a fitness company to just demonstrate classes. But as you can imagine, if someone said, right, here's a 20-minute dumbbell workout for your legs, off you go. Like, I'd do 4, 5, 6 of those a day, you know? So, yeah, there's breaks. And I'm not saying I was training for 10 hours. But, like, you know, I'd be most days hundreds of squats, hundreds of curls, hundreds of shoulder press. No question.
I liked what you said about the S&C drills. And I think what you've really taken away from them is you talked about being more attuned. I think you become more familiar with the skill of running. So you felt more familiar with certain body positions, how the body was moving between certain body positions, how the body should act stiffly rather than, you know, just running. And so you learned from doing drills where you're trying to develop certain physical qualities. You understood how they were playing because within the skill of running, because you actually felt it working. So then all of a sudden that you were more aware of how you're moving. And then that in turn made you a more efficient runner because the transfer was better because
despite the injury, which is, as people plan, you know, it's right on the ball of your foot right here. Despite that, I felt a better or more skilled. I mean, I put it this way. If someone had filmed me running, I'd like to think I looked like a more graceful, athletic, disciplined runner at the end of it than before. Now, obviously, you'd hope so. But as I point out, you know, I was pretty broken up by the time I did this on Saturday. I thought I'd look like a wobbly mess. But you're right. I felt smoother, quicker, more agile across the surface, despite the fact that the body wasn't actually moving as fast. You know what I mean? It felt slicker,
yeah,
more economical.
Those are the skills and the awareness which is going to lead to better running times in the future.
I hope so.
So I think, you know, the 8 weeks have actually been quite successful. The success doesn't manifest itself in the time. It's manifested itself in a lot of other
knowledge
things.
Knowledge and again, this isn't particularly interesting for those listening, but like, the enjoyment and the fulfillment from the series has come from like learning rather than the result. And I know there are these cliche phrases, which is, you know, it's not about the end result. It's about the journey. It's about the process. And I always think, bullshit, buy me a lottery ticket with winning numbers. I don't care about the, but when it comes to things like this, do you know what I mean by that? It's like, we'd all like to work our way up a ladder and at 80 you retire or win the lottery. And there's an Aston Martin out front by midnight. With this, it's like, actually the fun, the enjoyment has come in having problems, having to deal with them and thinking about, right, well, how is this going to benefit me when it comes to actually hitting the park tomorrow? Or this is an interesting movement that I'm trying to understand and learn. And you know, why am I trying to aim for this time on this day? You know, like, I'm a very visual guy. Like, I'm not very good with words and like, but when I see your charts and graphs and things, it's like, it's much easier for me to kind of follow on like actually doing the job. You know what I mean? Actually doing the running. Again, I keep thinking, like, how do I feel on reflection? Frustrated that I wasn't able to put my everything into your program. It wasn't the time. The time's not relevant. Like, maybe I'd be gutted if I put everything in and somehow ended up running 50 minutes, you know, of course. But the reality is I know I would have run faster. How much faster? I don't know. But the disappointment is that I wasn't able, whether it was my fault, just the life we live, you know, whatever was going on. I mean, the job was abroad. I didn't have a certain amount of clothing with me. You know, I finished the days at 10 p.m. And started a little later on. You know, the whole thing just meant that I wasn't able to give it my all. And I think we can all agree, whatever it is in life, you feel most disappointed with an exam result when you think, I didn't study for that one. You know, I should have put more time into that one. It's very rarely the one where you think, oh, I did all the work, I tried so hard, and it just wasn't my day. You know, like, that's easier to live with for me. Yeah. It's harder to live with the fact that, like, Fred, you had the fucking, you know, all you need to do is just do the work. So in a weird way, I'm fairly relaxed and calm about it, because I kind of knew 3 weeks out, I was like, this, it's going to be luck. And in a weird way, Phil, I thought in my head, because I'm an arrogant fucker, I was like, what happens if I go and do this? What happens if I just go out today and just bosh it, right? Injuries, been away, carbs, pizza, pasta, like, what happens if I go and boss it? And I'd almost have felt fraudulent. Do you know what I mean? I'd almost have felt like either I come at this from a very good base level, or fuck the training plan. It's not that important. And I'm glad it is. I'm glad that actually, no, you know, you took your foot off the gas. I didn't take my foot off the gas. You know, I was doing a lot of physical work. But in terms of following the program, I wasn't perhaps as regimented or structured as I could have been or should have been, whoever's fault that may have been. And therefore, I didn't run as fast a time as I'd hoped. That's good. That's good for me to know. That shows that the more effort, the harder the work I put in, probably the greater the result. Do you know what I mean? I would have felt a bit like I kind of cheated. Yeah, showed up three weeks later, and just, it would have put all of our like really detailed work to kind of, maybe it works for some, but other people are just lucky. You know, I don't buy into that philosophy. I think anyone that's good has worked hard.
I think something similar has happened to quite a few people. Like I often see on like social media, you'll have someone that will do like a 5K. And then all of a sudden, like a few days later, they do 5K again. Then they'll do a 5K again. And they'll get better each time. And they'll show off their new PBs and it looks good. But if you're only doing the same thing over and over again, you're going to get some very acute adaptations, which are going to improve performance. And you're going to get more familiar with the test. So it's likely you're going to see quick improvements at the beginning, but you're going to plateau very, very quickly early on. So quite often with these people, they reach like a peak 5K time. And then it's like, the next time I did it, I didn't go as fast. And then they kind of stop.
And they complain.
They don't understand. They don't understand.
No, like, not in a horrible way, but they go, why am I not losing more time? I often hear that. So I ran 21:20 trying to be... So I went out, I did 5K around 20:30, and then I went 24. I'm like, okay, it's not a reflection of your hard work, but as you say, just doing the same thing all the time, you're going to get a few
increases at the beginning, but if you're just doing the same thing over and over again, you're going to plateau, and it likely you're going to
go
back down because the body's probably knackered. So it does highlight. Now, I'm glad people would see someone who does something really quickly and sees very good like results, but over a very short period of time, because likely it's going to come from just being familiar with what you're doing. Like if you see that as like, oh, this guy knows what they're doing, I need to find out what they are doing. Like I would always look for advice over someone that's seen success, that has consistently improved over a long period of time, because that means they know what they're doing. So if you've got like a coach who's working with a runner that PBs in 2017, PBs again 2018, PBs 2019, like they're consistently getting better. They're not seeing some massive, huge peak and then they get worse. They are consistently getting better. Those are the coaches I think have a better understanding of what it takes to get to a high level. And they also have the patience to coach in that way as well. So yeah, if you're thinking about what's important, like what's progress theory? Progress theory is all about small improvements day by day to get better very slowly over time. You know, there's no like real peak. We want to get better and better and better. I think some other people call it like 1% every day or something like that. This actually has sort of like research behind it, more so from the business field, but I think it applies very much to the sports field as well. So if we're using...
And also that's the kind of... Do you know, I mean, maybe I'm... Is that not the kind of person and kind of athlete you want to be? Like, I've got no desire to go out tomorrow, run 38 minutes in a 10K and then balloon it to like 58. You know, I want to be consistent. I want to be able to confidently know what I'm capable of doing on a given day. And I've always kind of been about, whether I've phrased it necessarily as progress theory, in my life, it's always like, I know I fucking be able to deadlift 500 kg tomorrow, like chip away at it. And some people don't. And this comes back to that journey over the result and all these kind of things. Yeah, it's all relative. But when it comes to this, you're absolutely right. It's like the athletes and the people I respect are the people that do it three Olympics, you know, or the fighter that does it over a 10-year career, rather than he took the fight last minute, knocked out Masvidal, and it suddenly he's the great. Well, put him in the ring next week. Can he can keep that up? Do you see what I mean? I've often thought about that as an analogy. It's like, you know, you go into a fight, it's a 12-week camp. You analyze your opponent, you work on your strengths, what you need to change, and you put together a program. But quite often what happens is someone gets injured and someone goes, you want to fight him? It's 3 days away in Vegas. You're not going to make a plan. You're going to go in with whatever you've got, and sometimes you hit him in the right part of the chin, and that would be the equivalent to me of bossing it in 39 minutes and 30 seconds. But there's no longevity to that. And to be honest, yeah, there's some short-term enjoyment and pleasure, but really it's that 12-week process that separates the greats from the, you know, the consistent high-level shit. You know, I've always thought that. And I actually think the 8 weeks is enough time to make progress and keep it kind of fresh. You know what I mean? Like, I get distracted and bored easily at the best of times. So in my head, I'm like, actually, 8 weeks is a great, great window to really focus, to really double down. It's like a term, you know?
I mean, we chose 8 weeks, but I guess we could have done 12. We did this, we did that. We just thought, you know, 8 weeks, let's go for it. Let's see how much we can improve in that time. Let's see if we can get under 20 minutes and under 40 minutes.
I really want to do it again.
We didn't, but we improved. we improved in some way, and you can improve in various different metrics. So I think without trying to, I hope people don't think, you know, these guys are just trying to find an excuse for something that didn't quite come true. Well, technically we've improved in many different areas. So like it's been a really good, I think it's very good.
I'll put it this way, and I hate to say this, if I was injury free and you gave me another week, I'd definitely get a PB. Definitely. Like it's the injury to me. I definitely improved on the 44. Whether I beat sub 40, I doubt it. But who knows? I felt confident. Like my heart, my lungs, everything. I feel good. You know, like I feel good. There's no part of me that's like, oh. You know, and take a week out from the job in Italy. I actually did a lot of physical work out there that probably made me stronger in some other ways and kept me, you know, kept the engine running. There's, you know, I'm half tempted to go back out and do it, but it's not important. The result is no longer important. And I'd just be trying to justify something in my head, which is not what this is about. This is about settling on a plan, coming at it with an educated and informed reasoning, you know, and that's where you come into this field big time, which is, you know, you are the top level of what you do. This is what, I mean, people should be paying you to write this program for me. Like, you know, you're as knowledgeable and as educated on the subject as one can be. And I get you. You know, when I didn't make it and I knew you didn't make it, I was like, I don't want people to listen to this and think they're talking shit. No, the truth is we've come at this with an educated and informed set of sort of measure. What would you say? It's like the program has been designed with as much care and attention to the specifics, to the research, to, you know, our lifestyles, you know, and we didn't quite hit it, but you definitely made an improvement. Call me arrogant. I would have made an improvement. I know I would have. I'm in tune enough with my body to know I would have made an improvement. And whether it was beating time or simply making an improvement, that's enough. And we would tweak a few things. And as you said, you'd make it 7 days and I'd probably make sure I wasn't working abroad and maybe the Center Parcs trip would have been pushed back a week. But we did what we set out to do, which was improve on our current time.
Yep. And,
you know,
and we wanted to do it taking into account that we're doing this with full-time jobs and it's real life. So,
and I know it's a bullshit excuse because everyone's doing it, and all the COVID, all the, like, you know, all these things that just make everything a little bit more stressful. I'm proud of the 8 weeks. I would have, of course, done things differently and hoped for some different circumstances in others, but I'm ready. Like, this has got legs, you know, this is how it should be done. You should, you know, I'm optimistic. You know what I mean? Like, I think this is like, I'm kind of basically saying to the world, with Phil by my side, I can do anything.
Exactly.
So
tag team champion.
What's your conclusion to this thing? Cause I'm conscious, looking back now, like your overall reflections, what went well, what went bad, what would you change, and what are you looking for going forward?
I think, like, this program ended up being very successful because we wanted to improve as runners. By improving as runners, we wanted to see if we can get better at a particular test, which was the 5K, to hit a certain target. I think the target was probably a bit too ambitious, but that doesn't mean that everything that we did wouldn't improve you as a runner. Like, there was very specific to work on key metrics which would improve running, and we focus on running at different paces based on heart rate to make sure that we were improving in different areas, whether it's, you know, we're trying to develop running economy, our ability to sort of flush out lactate, anything like that. Everything was geared towards improving as a runner, and which, you know, we did. So people should think about utilizing some of the things that we've talked about in these podcasts when it comes to emphasizing their own running. Certainly the science still is the same. Practical application became a little bit difficult and that affected certain things. But ultimately we wanted to utilize this podcast to talk about how we made decisions. Mm-hmm. And in this podcast in particular, we are reflecting on decisions that we made and the outcomes of them. So for one thing was me rearranging training so I could get certain runs done before being away for 4 days. And then all of a sudden it was probably a bit too much, pushed a bit too much there. That caused an injury, which made me miss something else. You know, these are all things that we reflect on. Like, it's all trial and error. So hopefully from making it very transparent how we made these decisions, what transpired, what was the result, that whole thing is going to provide information that ourselves and anyone else listening can utilize for their own decision-making when it comes to making programs for improving their own running.
So couldn't I think agree that more. Was and a big thing. And also remember, this is our first series or season. We're coming to this, you know, we're not podcasters. We don't do this for a living. And I don't think it was always going to be perfect. And even excluding the running, just the podcast itself, our communication, our lifestyles, you know, the time I have to allow, like, all these little things it's learning, you know what I mean? And I'm convinced that if we were to do this again in 2 weeks' time, maybe we'd start in a slightly different place and we'd make it. It's like, I don't think the learning and the decision-making is just specific to running. You know what I mean? I think this project itself has brought a lot to light. And going forward, we're going to be making decisions and choices externally from whatever event or skill we're attempting next.
I'm excited.
Have you enjoyed it? Do you feel like you're happy?
Yeah, I'm really happy, but at the same time, I think this has scratched the surface. Like, just made me more hungry, whether it's from like physical performance way, but it's also from like a podcasting way.
Yeah,
I'm very hungry to try and do.
I'm really hungry specifically for the. I love the learning. Mm. I spend so much time like running and lifting weights and telling other people what to do that I get sometimes not bored. But when I listen to, especially the second and third episode, like I feel like as a listener, do you know what I mean? I'm like learning, I'm developing as a professional. And that's what I particularly enjoyed. You know, I love working out. This is why we both kind of do jobs that we do. It's because we like that. I knew that. But I wasn't the best, you know, school kid because I wasn't particularly interested in certain things. And I found like a real interest in learning about how I can put my body and the things that you taught us to good use. I don't want to play that off, Phil. You've spent hours and hours and hours. I don't think everyone at home realizes like Phil's done 90% of the heavy lifting for this because he's first of all 90% better looking, 90% stronger, and just 90% more knowledgeable. But it's really your wisdom that has even got us close, or me close to feeling the way I do. And long may it continue, my friend.
Certainly. I mean, it's a sports science show. And with podcasts and different ways of learning now, people are learning differently. So now it's a chance to like really emphasize that. Yep. We want people to join this journey. And the best way of doing that is to teach each other. So that's what we're trying to do.
And also just to finalize, we're never going to bullshit you. We could have come on here and gone, we both made it and we made the best decisions and followed the podcast. You know, like we vowed to each other and to you guys, like totally transparent. The pros, the cons, the injuries, the upsets, whatever it was. And there it was, you know, didn't quite make it. Both pretty happy with how it went. And like, there's more to come. So stay tuned kind of thing, right? I mean, like, there's not a lot more. Like, we're not going to sugarcoat it. There were some injuries, there were some problems. But on moving on. Take it. Let's go. Let's
fucking moving go. On. LFG.
LFG. Well, I was thinking maybe we could check in with the listeners in like a couple of days with a mini, like what's going to happen going forward, because obviously there'll be a season 2 and 3 and 4 and we'll eventually be in double figures and chasing down Rogan. But for now, that's kind of season 1 wrap up. And what I'd love though, and I'm not sure it's going to happen, but I hope that someone writes, I do think it's going to happen. I hope someone writes to us and said, I did the 5K and I made it, or I shaved a minute off my PB, or I did the 10K and I didn't quite make it, but I gained 30 seconds or whatever. So stay letting us know, even if it's not immediately, if you decide to do this at a later date, just write to us and let us know how you got on, because that's a real joy for me, trying to help other people like Phil's helping.
Exactly. Exactly. We want everyone to join this journey. So
let's do it.
Get involved.
And always just get better and better each day.
Progress theory.
Progress theory. Progress. So let's try and do that. Let's do this again. You ready? This is our new thing. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Oh, you got me quicker than that. Hold on. Ready? Should we count now? 3, 2, 1. High five.
No, you went slow.
High five.
Are we going on 4?
It's that spud 3. That we did in the second episode. So
big love, brother. I now have to go and teach class, I'm afraid, ladies and gentlemen. I've got 4 minutes. So I'm going to say thank you for listening. Stay tuned for series 2. And Phil, love you like a brother, mate.
Love me.
Progress theory. Laters.
Take it easy, guys.
Take it easy, brother.